pull up and put this up. In compliance with chapter 231, public law 1975, entitled Open Public Meeting Act, adequate notice of this meeting has been provided as specified in the act. Proper notice of this public meeting was provided in the notice of, said notice was posted at the entrance of the Board of Education office, mailed to the Nutley Southern Star Ledger in North Jersey, Herald News and Nutley Journal, mailed to the Nutley Township Clerk, advertised in the Nutley Sun, posted on the district website. This is an official meeting. Have a flag salute, please. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Roll call, Mr. Caputo.
Mr. Cardicello?
Yes.
Mrs. Sanchez Martin?
Here.
Mr. Ferrara?
Here.
Mr. Klein?
Here.
Mr. Riley? Ms. Russo?
Here.
Mr. Scalera?
Here.
Mr. Spazzato? Mr. Kaczynski?
Here. I need the approval of the minutes from the June 9th, 30th meetings and July 10th meetings. Motion. Second, someone?
Patrick.
Second, Ted Russo. Correspondence? All in favor, I'm sorry, all in favor of that?
Aye.
Aye.
All in favor, did I hear an aye?
Aye.
Okay, thank you. Correspondence? None?
None.
Presentations, Mr. Levin.
All right, we changed the order, but Mr. Bane is up first. Presentation on science curriculum, Mr. Bane.
Thank you for this opportunity to speak about science curriculum. Very excited to finish up our year of program review and the curriculum review. I feel like every time I get up here, my presentation doesn't work, but it'll be a brief presentation about our process, really. Ian, is there something I need to do here? I can start with our process. Beginning this year, last year at this time, I started the process of looking at our science department K-12. And this process is new to Nutley, and it was very exciting to begin, and now it's even more exciting to end with the curriculum draft. But our process throughout the year took a look at where we were, what the standards were, how do we get to where we want to go, where do we want to go, how do we get there. And science, it was interesting because things started happening a little sooner the previous year with a little grant money that came in and our a program that we brought in a pilot a little earlier than this process. The process really allowed us to take a look at our new standards that have come online, allowed us to take a look at kind of our old documents, and really the goal was to make a useful document that teachers could use for this year to edit, update, and put into effect.
Why don't you use the computer?
I can talk, really. Science, we were kind of at a crossroads in standards, the first thing to take a look at. Our standards were the 2009 curriculum content standards in science. There were four parts to those, and three of those parts were content-based. Earth science, life science, and physical science, chemistry involved in there. One part of that was science practice. Our standards have shifted now, and you're decided to adopt the next generation science standards this past month, which is great news for us, to two-thirds of it being scientific practice. Where science is going standard-wise is driven by scientific practice. What scientists do, we want to see kids doing that, we want to see kids thinking, analyzing, discussing. It's all lined up. On a slide, you can see the three dimensions of next generation science there. Dimension one would be the scientific practices, what a scientist does. Mostly scientific method things, You know, they're making hypotheses, they're testing, they're observing, they're analyzing, they're coming to conclusions, they're predicting. The second dimension is the dimension of cross-cutting concepts, things that scientists do, trends they look for, cause and effect, stability, change. All of these are packaged in that second dimension. The third dimension is their content in next-gen science centers. So we go from a two-thirds shift, from a one-third shift to a two-thirds shift with next-gen science standards. Our curriculum document, the next slide I want to show you, it was really a Venn diagram of things we want in our curriculum document. We wanted to look at the standards, three sets of standards really. At the time we started this, we didn't know if they were going with the core curriculum common standards or next-gen standards, so both those sets of standards, as well as the Common Core Language Arts and Math standards. Those are very important to us as well. So in the beginning part of our curriculum document, we've listed all the standards that our curriculum supports. 2009, next-gen, and Common Core. The second half of our document is for the teacher, and I call that the planning part. This is where the document goes for the teacher to plan how to reach these standards, what to do, essential questions during understandings, big ideas, even lesson objectives, right? Important to us were the investigations that got our kids acting like scientists, and those were all listed there as well. Resources, language arts connections, math connections were all in the document. So that was the second part. The first part was the standards. The second part was the, for the teacher, the planning part. The next slide was all the teachers that helped us get there. These teachers were great. They were leaders at every grade level at the high school. K-8, we had one teacher per grade level. And at the high school, we had one per major subject area. They really took the initiative to make this draft happen. If you bring up that slide again, that would be great. Okay, so the process. Yeah, we can start there, that's fine. So this is what we look for in a useful curriculum document. We wanted something that teachers could use and that parents could see. And really, we wanted to reflect our standards, and we just didn't write it to one set of standards, we wrote it to three sets of standards we thought was very important, as well as planning. And those are all things that we believe are important for teachers. So enduring understanding, essential questions, learning outcomes, learning objectives, cross-discipline, investigations, bold and highlight. This was very important to us in science. Have to get the kids doing science. Science is a verb, right? And that's very important. Writing and teaching. Here's our team that put it together for us. They really, K-8, we did three units, each of these, and they kind of took our Carolina program that was put out by the Smithsonian. They went through it, and they took that material and transcended it into a curriculum document so we could use. 9-12 is a little different. They took the various areas, a little more specialized, a little more content-driven, and put that into our curriculum template so we could use. So you see all of these making all these teachers made a draft document. And really some of the highlights of that draft document, we have units. So each of our curricula, different levels, different grades, are separated in units. Anywhere from 3 units to 7 units. They have the standards from 2009 New Jersey, core curriculum kind of standards, next gen standards, which we're moving to, and Common Core Language Arts and Math. So all those standards are involved. Big picture, enduring understanding, essential questions are there for the teachers. Really, this is probably the area where we need to modify and work as we go through the year of this draft. Learning outcomes, what students will be able to do, as well as what students will learn. And I think that's very important, the second one, what students will be able to do in science, against acting like a scientist. Investigations, which was very important. And this was the teachers put in places for common assessments. It kind of worked out where at the end of each unit, the teacher found that that was a great spot for a common assessment. They did not necessarily write the common assessment, but they put in a place for that common assessment. And that's, again, something we're going to work on this year is making the assessments for those areas. And resources. Again, this is a draft, so this year we want to update and go through it. Really, that's my presentation. Thank you again for this.
I would just like to make a comment that I was fortunate enough to see the whole presentation, and I thank you for the time that you're doing, the teachers are putting in. Not to say that it's long overdue, but it's certainly going to be a breath of fresh air, and I'm looking forward to it coming all the way down into K.
Yep. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? Yes.
Yeah, I'd just like to state, I went into the Rotary Dictionary program, so I'm going to different elementary schools and asking about the kids and the projects. I talked to the kids and the teachers both, and I've never seen really that much excitement over science in the elementary, and kids explaining to me what they were doing, and the teacher jumping in, The teachers were actually excited also about it in the classroom. Why would happen? It's in fifth, third grade, so we go out and do dictionaries in third grade. So I just wanted to add great feedback. I think you know, it's building, and I think it'll be a real impact.
Thank you so much.
Mr. Matt, I did want to thank Mr. Bain. This has been kind of a year and a half to 2 year project as opposed to the single year. And Dr. Bonney is part of this curriculum review process we talked about. Moving into these 5 years, every year has a rationale and a reason for being. It's not just these pieces, so we have a lot of work. Just very quickly, we share a number of articles as staff, right? And one of the things Sir Ken Robinson put out an article recently, he was talking about a study they did on creativity in England. And they studied the responses of kindergartners and fifth graders as far as measuring creativity. And what they found was the kindergartners were far more creative than the fifth graders. And by looking at the results, they're seeing that through school, oftentimes we're kind of teaching kids out of being creative and just there's one answer. Whereas the approach that Mr. Bain, this new science process is taking is to ask the good questions and see what those answers are and go through data the right way. We're really teaching kids to think and really looking to see exciting things at the science fair. And what this can do. The other piece is I do have to thank the teachers. We got Roche with that wonderful donation, and the district came up with, you know, 5/6 of the money. But the teachers really, this is a huge shift. Mr. Vania has been, he kind of split himself scientifically somehow into 7 different people because he's in all the elementary buildings as well as the middle high school. There are hours of preparation so that the kids can physically do the science. And they jumped in. We haven't really heard any complaints, and we've got, as Mr. Scalera evidenced, some really great feedback on this. So it's an exciting time. So thank you for your work. As always, I know you wait with bated breath. We have Mr. Capello with us. He talked to us about harassment, intimidation, and how the board can further bully people.
Oh, you're right. Well, good evening, everyone. As part of the Anti-Bullying Bill of Rights, we are required to let and I to present to the Board of Education at a public meeting our self-assessment. As per the Anti-Bullying Bill of Rights, at the conclusion of each school year, each school safety team must assess their HIV initiatives. Do we have the
Mr. Bang, you have no computer. He had no computer, and you weren't getting the remote.
He's bullying me. All right. So last year at this time, Anti-Bullying Bill of Rights, I believe it was September 2011. So last year I presented school self-assessment, the scores for the previous year. So here we are again, a year later, doing the same thing for this past school year. Just to give you some information, what the state does, they provide us with a 40-page rubric. Okay? That rubric is broken down into 8 core elements, and each core element has indicators. So there's a core element, each indicator represents, this is what, are you doing this, this, and this? If you are doing this, according to the rating categories, you exceed it, meet it partially, or you do not meet the requirements at all. So that's where you get your numbers and your scores from. Right? Now, when you do provide yourself a score, you do need to be mindful that if you are going to give yourself a score, you also need to provide documentation of that, sample documentation. So when we were rating ourselves, we have to ensure that if the state ever came in, do we have the documentation to back up our scores? Right? Just to give you a brief knowledge. Core element number 1, 5 indicators, are we establishing, implementing, and assessing our programs and initiatives? Are our programs, approaches, and initiatives, are we addressing HIV, which is harassment, intimidation, and bullying? Is the school safety team identifying and reviewing the school climate? Core element number 2, are we training our staff of our HIV policies and procedures? I believe in the beginning of the year, September, we had a refresher course for all the staff district-wide. Last August, I presented at the administrators' retreat. August, I also presented at the coaches' academy to instruct all the coaches of what we need to do. Also, throughout the course of the school year, when new staff was hired, I met with them as groups, and I conducted 7 of those trainings. Core element number three, there are also five indicators. We provided instruction on HIV and prevention. In October, we did a whole district-wide presentation on suicide prevention, and also how it relates to bullying. We're providing in-service training to our anti-bullying staff. I am the anti-bullying coordinator, but we also have an anti-bullying specialist who oversee the initiatives in each school. Core element four, are we providing age-appropriate instruction according to the core curriculum content standards? Also, are we observing week of respect, which is required as per the anti-bullying Bill of Rights, the first week of October? Core element number five, if you just saw the last board, our last meeting, Board of Ed meeting, the anti-bullying specialists were approved for next year. We did that last year for this past school year. So they are being appointed by the principals. It's being Board of Ed approved. Are they meeting with the school? Is the school anti-bullying specialist, are they meeting with their school safety team at a minimum twice per year? And we've exceeded that. Core element number six, are we reporting HIV incidents, the procedures? Our staff is following procedures. Core element number seven, are we notifying parents? Completing investigation in 10 days, which these are all requirements as per the anti-bullying Bill of Rights. Are we preparing a written report? Is Mr. Lazak receiving those reports within 2 days that they are completed? Core element number eight, HIV reporting. Are the staff following our policy? Are they verbally reporting it on the same day, and then are they completing a written report within 2 days? Also, do we have our official grades posted from last year? We do have them posted. We've had them posted since they came out. I believe it was the end of March they've been posted. Okay. So here's our, here's the last year's school assessment was based upon a max score of 75. If you see here, the state increased it to a 78. 3 points were added if you are posting the grades within 10 days of receiving them. So here are our grades. One of the things that we do recognize in core element number one is our need to conduct more surveys. That's what the state likes to do. They would like us to do, because it's all about being data-driven. Are we conducting surveys to our staff, to our students? How do they feel? So that's one of the areas that we know that we need to work on. So if you see core element, everything else is probably basically similar. Core element number one, you can see that there are some differences. So we are working on that. I actually have a meeting with the anti-bullying specialist this coming Thursday to address these concerns. And also to let you know, compared to our scores from the previous years, our numbers have greatly increased. Where do we go from here? Once the scores are presented to the Board of Ed, Mr. Lazovic, and they are approved by the Board of Ed, Mr. Lazovic then certifies them electronically to the state. He also has to complete a statement of assurances, which includes this evening's date. Once we do receive the grades, they must be posted within 10 days on each school's website as well as the district website. And once we do receive the grade, once again, I have to present to the Board of Ed. Incidentally, last year at this time, I presented the grades prior to submitting them, and I thought the state was gonna possibly shake it up a little, give us a different grade, but basically they gave us the same grade. So I think it was the March Board of Ed meeting, I came in and presented the same numbers. So, thank you.
Thank you so much. We appreciate the work and time that you put into this. I know you've been on top of it. Certainly the grades reflect that, and I appreciate the work that you and your people do. It's a problem throughout the country. I know you know that, and let's never find ourselves in that situation. So I appreciate whatever you're doing.
Thank you.
And your staff.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Capello. Again, both Mr. Capello and our actual specialists in the building do a great deal of work, as you know, as the principals, in not just really staying in compliance with the ongoing Bill of Rights, but making sure we're doing everything possible we can for our students. And you've seen presentations tonight on our curriculum. You've seen another presentation on how we're doing, you know, fostering the whole child character, self-esteem, working against bullying. But at the end of the day, we are certainly an academic institution. I'm happy to stand up and present, as I always do, on our student performance data. The College Board released our advanced placement scores, as I briefed everyone on, but there will be a presentation. I've met with the academic committee on this, and the administrative committee saw a brief piece, but at the end of the year, we're constantly waiting this to build our rates to see who can get into College Board's database first, and we break things down, and we build our spreadsheets, and this is what we do in the summer. But as a point of comparison, again, some things to mention again. When you look at advanced placement data, it's impossible really to cohort. You're looking at two completely different years, two different groups of students taking different groups of tests, and the way College Board actually scores the AP test, you cannot use one year's scores to reflect growth or lack thereof from one year to the next, because they score not just against the criterion of the assessor, but they score against the performance of that year's cohort. So the scores never truly line up. You can't say that five this year is the same as a five last year or a five 10 years prior. But we do. We look to see how we're getting our kids ready for performances this year. As you can see, the first thing I did was show the percentage of our students scoring again advanced placement. The overall scores, the raw scores, the raw data is computed through their wonderful computers, and then end up giving us a score of 1 through 5. 1 and 2 by College Board can be considered as not passing, not proficient. 3, 4, and 5 being considered proficient. But again, as we've talked about, 4 and 5, really when you're talking about colleges and majors, they're looking for a score of at least a 4, although a 3 will be considered proficient. Now, I've been up here for 3 years. We've talked about how we're trying to make sure that what we're teaching in the class is congruous with what's being assessed on these assessments. We've built specific common assessments. We've had multiple meetings with the teachers. We've had parent meetings. And as you can see from last year to this year, there's a marked improvement or increase in the percentage of students who are scoring 3, 4, and 5. And what you see there is that the greatest number of amount of improvement actually happened in 3 and 4, with minimal improvement for 5. What we really want to see is every single one of our students, I'll talk about this later, taking at least one advanced placement course if they have aspirations for college. But again, so from last year to this year, our performance has increased. I think this is a better chart. On the left, where you see not passing, this is the percentage of students who have not been passed or did not pass. On the right, the percentage of students who are passing. 3 years ago, 2012, 45% of our students did not pass, which means 55% of our kids did. These are our best students taking our most rigorous classes, and basically 1 out of 2 was passing. Just so we have some point of comparison, for the nation of students taking AP classes, you're talking about 60-61% of students actually passing. So we were far below the national average, but as you hopefully can clearly see from this slide, not only did we go up last year, but we have now increased our scores over the previous 2 years. So we're showing continued growth. Again, a greater focus. I have to give a lot of credit to Mr. Davila, but also Mr. Williams. He's met with his AP teachers, advanced placement teachers, multiple times during both of these years. We talked about our use of performance matters, our common assessments, and what we need to do in those classes to improve the learning environment of students and therefore their performance. But again, very proud of our teachers and certainly our students for this consistent growth. What we'd like to see are more students in these classes and a continuation of this. Now again, 71% of our students were proficient. That's about 10% over the national average, and that's a whopping score, almost 3/4 of our kids. We want to improve, yes. We're still working on that. Put a different way, one of the things, the College Board has given us a number of new reports this year. Again, it's like Christmas in July for Mr. Davila and myself. One of the things they allowed us to do is, based on our graduating classes, determine how many of our students took at least one AP assessment and passed, scoring at least a 3. So again, many of these students may have taken 2, 3, 4 assessments, but if you take the graduating class of Nutley High School in 2011, 12, 13, and 14, and you look at how many of our graduating seniors took and passed at least one class, as you can see, from 2011 to 2013-14, we went from below teens to below 20s as far as our percentage, and we want to see more. That's a marked increase in 2 years. This is the same data you just saw shown pictorially. Visually, again, I like the graphs, but as you can see, we've had an increase, and again, a little bit of a dip, but we're over 20%. national average for all high schools, you're talking about 20 to 25%, somewhere in there, about a quarter of the kids, less than a quarter of the kids in the school. Now, we're not shooting for average, obviously. So we want to see these numbers continue to grow. I know you can't read, but again, I tried to use color. We didn't stop with the reports that they gave us. We exported the raw data, and we used other reports that they were giving to combine. And what this shows us is it gives us the mean score by each of our assessments. So every student who took at least one test in these categories, we're going running along the top, how their mean score as a pool compared against the state of New Jersey, compared against the country, and compared against the entire global community that's taking advanced placement assessments. What I try to do here with the green and the red is, as you can see, any place that's red is where we fell below the mean of that group. Again, New Jersey, United States, global. As you can see, it's overwhelmingly green to begin. So not only are we passing the assessments, but we're passing with higher scores, higher average scores, than those other populations. And I would hope that we're above the global. I would hope that we're above the United States, but New Jersey is a target that we thought we would really be shooting for, because as a state, we're a high-performing state. And as you can see, mean score-wise, we are doing fairly very well. Again, it's not really indicative of the individual teacher or the kids or the rest as far as which are red. And we're talking in those red, and if you can see the numbers, sometimes we're off by 0.08, 800 of a mean point. When we had 60 kids take a test, you're talking about one more kid scoring one more point. So our kids performed extremely well, and we're proud of them. Also looking at the percentage passing, so again, scores of 3, 4, and 5, as you'll see again, New Jersey, the country, and the global community taking advanced placement, our students did extremely well as far as percentage passing. So not only are we increasing, as I showed from the charts below, but we are performing better than the state of New Jersey as a whole, certainly the country, and the global community. Where we're really working though, and you see the difference here, that's the first chart, that's the second. We're really pushing these those higher scores, 4s and 5s. And again, I give us at least 50-50 as far as green-red. At the same time, that's a marked increase. If you remember just 3 years ago when we looked at the advanced placement data, the majority of our students were failing. So forget the 4s and 5s. If I look back at this chart, it would be predominantly red. Okay, so what we're trying to show is this work of the board, our strategic work, the work of our professionals, not just at the high school, but across the K-12 continuum. Our students are growing and we're seeing the results. We saw on the HESPA, we are anxiously awaiting our ASP data, which should come in about 2 weeks. And we'll start breaking that apart and certainly hope to have a presentation for the August meeting on our ASP. Last piece on this again is with the changes in science, with the changes in PE, which I had a presentation on before, with our changes in math, the changes in language arts, we want more students to be better prepared earlier. So they come into the high school already targeting these classes, knowing what they have to do to get there progression-wise, and they're prepared not only for the course, but they perform exceptionally well in the assessments. I'm very proud of our staff and students. Questions?
Thank you, Mr. Westbrook. And again, most of us were privy to their presentation before. It clearly spells out the advancement you're making and because of you and your staff.
Staff, students, parents, everyone involved, the meetings, the parents. I will certainly post the presentation online once the meeting's over so people can review.
Thank you. You're up again.
I'm up again.
Russ, will that be posted with your notes? Like I can see the screen, there's some notes about each one to explain how the parents are going to look at that and not really know.
I would close with those notes, but I can write something up certainly.
Just something, because they'll look at it, you don't know what we're trying to say there, so you can just put it in.
Absolutely. I just want to know how much math is there for the PowerPoint work and the...
That's right, you have
Superintendent's report. First and foremost, I think she walked in. Ms. Lacetius, you can stay standing. I want to personally say thank you. Well, the work you did for the ELSM program, the teachers were fantastic. Dr. Mott, Mr. Kaczynski, and I certainly all attended the culminating event. Loved the music, although the singing Frozen was certainly a hit. We had parents and children breaking into song. It was a really, really great experience for kids, so thank you for all that you did.
No, I was very fortunate to be involved in a program back when my daughters were in school through the Vector program and so on. And now living it with my grandchildren, the excitement was there. The what they were building, what they were involved in, there's so much more that they can be involved in now. It's fantastic. I know it's a busy summer, a busy month for you. I appreciate the work that you and your staff put in.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
time, if it's offered next summer, I have to make sure you have to play some Quidditch. So again, thank you, and again, the success with a lot of parents, great feedback, wonderful turnout, so I'm just looking forward to that. They said today, I just want to reiterate to the board the communication that came out from Mrs. Zerovsky's office that we're doing everything we can to ensure now that for each day that school is open for students, we will have beforehand aftercare. And that message has been delivered, and we're making sure with the association and the principals that we can live up to that, but we believe we're there. Mr. Carnestella, Mr. Ferrara, I met on Friday to go over Mr. Viemeister's work, Mr. Ferrara's work, Dr. Klein's work on re-registration. We went through a number of questions, came up about six different things, but at this point in time, we're ready to pilot the web-based system that Mr. Viemeister's put together to work with our feedback. Hopefully will cut down on the work parents have to do, but our goal is to re-register over the next week or two a small group. Select parents, get feedback from them on the website, making changes based on their interaction with it. And then after that feedback and those changes have been made, to blast this out to everyone. The goal being now through the early fall to re-register every current student who has not registered to the district in the past year. Based on that information, as we talked about, there are five or six different things that we need to do. We've been working with the town. I want to thank Commissioner Evans and his staff for giving us information, but hopefully improve that partnership so that we make sure that none of these schools are being attended by Nutley students. Facilities update. I visited Lincoln School today. We have a number of projects going on. The first is redoing all the wood floors, which have not been done apparently since they were installed. They do look brand new. I'm concerned more people are going to slip. But they look fantastic. Mr. Nicolette was there with me as we walked the building. I know Ms. Yeamans had a big hand in putting this together, and right now everything going exactly as the plan. They were just striping the gym as we were there. So looking forward to that. We were standing in what will be in September the new main office, which has moved to the front of the building, and we visited what will now be a new third grade classroom where the main office used to be. The contractor was in, and we met with the jobs foreman, and it looks like everything right now will be on point, so when we open, we'll have a new main office as well as a new third grade classroom. We are waiting on the special order, security door with glass and the rest, and as soon as that is received, we will install that. If that doesn't come before the end of the year, we still flip the building, the beginning of the year, sorry, we look to have it by the first week. Also at Lincoln School, we walked the grounds. But again, I want to thank Mr. Ferrar and Commissioner Scarpelli, as well as your crew. We met last week to go through. Mr. Ferrar has been working closely with Mrs. Jamins, just to make sure that all the I's are dotted and T's are crossed for both Lincoln School and Radcliffe. I know we've gone through to Mr. Barron and Commissioner Evans' office, the parking situation, so that we're prepared once we have repaved those blacktops to stripe accordingly and be moving some basketball. Nets and the rest, but all this work has been agreed upon. We're approving it tonight, and we should be opening school in September with brand new blacktops for both schools. I see some smiles on the lines. Finally, two more pieces. I was with Mr. Francia today at the high school. Work on the group is continuing. Ms. Sheamus informed Mr. Kaczynski, both the board members, of an unforeseen change order, but it will not change completion dates for the high school at this point in time. And hopefully, as of 15 minutes before the meeting, we're on point to get the contractor working on bleachers immediately and prepared for our opening football game. As a legal update, this past Friday, the highlight of my week, I met with Mr. Kaufman to discuss the upcoming mediation with TriTech. We met for about an hour and a half to go through the board strategy. Mediation set for August 26th with Judge Oliveri. He's a new judge. He's reviewed the entire case. For the first time, all players will be at the same table, or at least in three different rooms in the same boat. And we will see how that goes. I'll report back to Mr. Kaczynski and certainly the rest of the board as soon as that is over. I know he's not here, but we have to bring him. Mr. Dwyer, who is one of our social studies teachers at the high school, I have to congratulate him. He's a history teacher. Recently, he was published. He's been apparently working on this article for a number of years, on and off amongst his busy schedule. And his post, which I know is going to be so intriguing to most people here, but reconsidering mine host Thomas Morton's legal threat to the New England colonies, was published in the spring edition of the New England Journal of History. So we wanted to congratulate Mr. Dwyer. I've already sent him a letter and talked to him personally about it. I did read the article, which brought me back to my college days. It was right in the wheelhouse of my major, so it was an interesting walk through memory, stroll through memory lane. But congratulations to him. It really is a model of what we hope our teachers are doing, not just teaching and opening the minds of our kids, but staying involved in their content area and kind of pushing the boundaries right behind him. I mean, he has changed his own content area by adding new items. So congratulations to Mr. Dwyer. Philan Yu, current senior, this summer has been working as an intern at NJIT Physics Lab. He's presenting his NJIT summer research at their symposium for undergraduates this Thursday, July 30th. So we're wishing him the best and proud of his work so far. I know we updated the board a little bit ago, but just for public knowledge, we were approached by Brian Davenport, the representative from the Passaic Valley Sewage Commission, who helped work with the outdoor cleanup that we recently did here at the middle school. They would like to donate money to help us create an outdoor classroom in the Anacall Park that can be used both by the middle school classes and the high school classes. I've been in touch with Commissioner Tucci, Parks and Rec. He's working with us to make sure that we can kind of cooperate, collaborate on this, and allow the students kind of access to the river and the park as well for outdoor activity in combination with Mr. Bania and what we're doing work with environmental science and the sciences in general. Much fun, New Jersey Smart reporting at that time of year. Mrs. Alessio, Mr. Levine, Mr. Viemeister, Dr. Bellani, myself, student identification, our SID and our SMID updates have been uploaded without error, and we're finalizing our first time submission of the evaluation data. We have a couple of blanks to fill out, but it's not until next week. We're hoping to upload our first iteration tomorrow and then fix any issues that come back to us from the state. So we're a week ahead of the game. Our No Child Left Behind grant, we received notification on Thursday that's been approved by the state, which is great news. Again, coming out of special services, thanks to Mrs. Shamans and to Dorothy. I just spoke out of the office who helped me put that grant together to make sure we were ready to go. Advanced placement, I'm having the update just for public dissemination, but we are obviously just in the presentation. Mr. Levine, I want to make sure that I included a big thank you to the board for their assistance in changing the budget, making sure we kept our tech staff, because we've done so much this year in improving the learning environment technology-wise, and we've improved even more. Our technicians with Mr. Viemeister and their plan are currently running all over the buildings, making sure that when the students enter in September, we're unrecognizable as far as the amount of technology that we have in the elementary and middle high school. So thank you to all of them. Dr. Bellani and the nurses have been working on the AD process and policy. The first reading is on the agenda for tonight. It was reviewed by the administration committee. All the technology is already here and in buildings. People have been trained, and just this is the last piece before we train the whole staff and move forward in compliance with that. Now, the youth survey. Now, the academic committee has been working, and a good friend of ours, Dr. Reed, out of Montclair State, has the data. He will be analyzing it. And has agreed to obviously not respond, give us all that information once analyzed, but there will be no publishing the data until we give consent. Polling locations, still working with Commissioner Evans and Evelyn Rosario, but just to confirm that our polling locations, as promised, will be moved out of all buildings except for Spring Garden and the high school prior to the November election. Special services, Mrs. Hyde was here today. She's still transitioning to the district. Dr. Bellani and I went over her entry form with her. She's been working with Mrs. Joan Marino. She's the high school Mrs. DeSpoto. She's really started to take over some of the cases already and is looking forward to sitting down with CST. She will be sending out surveys to different surveys to members of the department, to the administrators, as well as the parents and to nurses to get some initial feedback before sitting down with the groups as a whole and in pieces. As well, we discussed her long and short-term goals today, and most specifically making sure she can help coordinate this year professional development for our general ed staff regarding special education matters. Kindergarten information, it's a good thing people want to be here. Space-wise is another story, but as of right now, we're at 277 confirmed students with another 53 to go. We'll be well above our 300 number. Yanacaw is still holding 88, and Washington School at 84. Other than that, our numbers are basically where we expected them to be. It's summer, and I want to thank the board again for approving the administrator's contract. Mrs. Powell is here. I saw her in the high school burden boxes. They are here over the summer. We are still offering professional development. We are getting all these new wonderful things for our health and physical education program being delivered to the high school, middle school, to the elementary schools, and she's diligently running around trying to make sure everything's prepared. I'm really looking forward to seeing that in action next year. The middle school staff have been coming in. Thank you again to the board for approving that. Working with Ms. Egan, Mr. Sullivan, and in their teams. So those houses are truly going to be prepared. We're gearing up for a large student orientation in the summer prior to opening, so people will come in and be introduced, whether 7th or 8th grade, into their new middle school model. And so it's an exciting time. It's nice to have everybody wrapped. It doesn't feel like summer. Everyone's in and out. We're all still talking about kids and they're learning. Finally, upcoming important dates. The first, just as a reminder, which I'm sure isn't necessary, but board retreat is Wednesday. Upstairs in the media center, beginning at 5:30. We have new teacher orientation coming up, as well as the orientation dates for the school, which are all posted on the website. And we already have our open house dates for September. Middle school on the 10th, elementary school is all on the 17th, and high school on the end, September 18th. Those are all also on the school website. Mr. Kuczynski.
Thank you. Mr. Kuczynski, just a minute, please. It's the last week. Can you make sure the air conditioning works this year? Usually goes out and it's stopped and turned on before we get here for the
retreat.
For the retreat?
The retreat? That was the plan, but yes, did you ask that?
It's never worked.
Don't worry, Bill's with me. Mr. Lazarek took a lot of my report already, so it'll be very short this evening. The handheld wireless devices, the FCC license is proceeding as expected, and we are expecting equipment to start installation the week of August the 4th. This evening, the board is also going to be approving removal of trees and trimming of a lot of the trees on New Street and at Radcliffe School and Lincoln School. Once the trees are removed at Radcliffe and Lincoln, then the paving contractor will be able to start on his work. I, too, would like to thank Mr. Carraro for scheduling the joint meetings with the town. They were extremely productive, and I think that we're all on the same page and making sure that the parking lots are paved correctly and the spaces are all to the dimensions that are required by the state. And I'd also like to thank Commissioner Scarpelli for his assistance with having the engineer help us out. Thank you.
There was some discussion, I know, about the trees in front of high school. Where do we stand with that?
We are going to also be including those trees in front of the high school, and we also have a tree here in the back of the middle school that needs to be addressed, and we have to receive additional quotes for that work. So we are going to be working on those this week, but in the meantime, we do have to move on these because, as I stated, we need this work to proceed so that we can get the paving done before September.
So when we get another bid for the high school, we'll be able to move right into that. We have to move to approve.
Yes.
Thank you. Committee reports.
I'm going to do the Finance Committee report on June 24th. We met. Mr. Lasvik, Mr. Kuczynski discussed with the members the potential acquisition of the land in order to expand the district property. One shared with the board committees. The district personnel would have to get approval through the town and State Department of Education. Mr. DeCaira and Mr. Watkins updated the committee on the status of the Lincoln School project, the high school roof, high school doors, all the projects they discussed. They discussed the permits, project timelines, and potential change order for high school ventilation. Mrs. Yemen reviewed July 28th finance agenda resolutions, including contracts, building use requests, donations, tree removal and trimmings, parking lot paving and transfers. The committee had a follow-up discussion on the bus lot and the possible option. Mr. Ferraro is scheduling a meeting with the potential renter and Mrs. Yemen's. The committee decided to issue its own garbage bid while it awaits the results of the town's bid to ensure the district receives the most favorable rate. I provided the committee with additional information on the web portal and plan options. The committee directed Mr. Yemens to contact IMAC for more details. Mr. Yemens reviewed the personnel recommendations for the building and grounds department. The committee also reviewed the updated job description for treasurer of school monies. Mrs. Yemens reviewed the board retreat items with the committee. Next meeting is scheduled for August 19th.
Thank you, Mr. Scorer.
Thanks, Mr. Kuczynski. The Administrative Committee met on July 22nd at 5 p.m. First thing that was discussed was athletics. Mr. Pyro, the Athletic Director, reviewed the 2013-14 school year. He reviewed the Coaches Academy. We had an update on the new evaluation process for the coaches.
specific updates on correction action processes, and the recommendation for the 2014-15 coaching positions, which you'll also find on the agenda today. Under personnel, we discussed the plan for permanent substitutes under the Affordable Health Care Act and the impact it may have on the school district or the rotating of substitute teachers. Reviewed job descriptions, secretary, human resources, secretary, superintendent, assistant superintendent, buildings and grounds custodian, buildings and ground maintenance and treasurer, all which will appear in the agenda tonight. We reviewed the personnel agenda, which is again on the agenda for tonight. We reviewed policies and regulations for first reading. Also, the preparation of the board retreat. We discussed the topics of the athletics, school board member training, buildings and grounds, review of school board self-assessment and superintendent evaluation, and an update on the Oval. Land acquisition, there was a discussion about some adjoining property that we might be looking at in the future. We discussed the superintendent's goals, based on both and update information from the College Board and the Department of Education. We recommended all the action on the policies that are on tonight and the personnel agenda that are also on tonight. And that was the remainder of the meeting. Thank you, Mr. Davis.
All right, Kaczynski. Mr. Weiner.
Academic Committee met on July 22nd. Heard two presentations that we heard tonight, the science curriculum as well as the AP data. Discussed the land acquisition that we've heard in the prior two committee meetings that they just mentioned. Agenda items were discussed, the mentoring plan for the upcoming academic year, the Delta Dental grant application, and the lifetime challenge for healthy living agreement. We discussed the board retreat preparation, the Nutley Youth Survey, and then the curriculum instruction update for phys ed and health, language arts and science, and brief discussion occurred about September P8.
Thank you. Any other committee reports? We now come to the portion of our meeting where we allow members of the public to address the board. In this section, we allow questions or comments on only the resolutions addressed in tonight's agenda. Our board regulation allows 20 minutes for these communications. Each person shall be limited to 3 minutes, and we ask you to try to stay within this requirement. Speakers may speak more than once, only after all others wishing to speak on the topic have been heard. All statements will be directed to me as the chairperson, no one may address board members individually. Please be reminded that if your statement is too lengthy, personally directed, abusive, obscene, irrelevant, or redundant, your participation may be terminated. Please remember to always state your name and address each and every time you address the board. The first person can step forward. Hearing none, we'll move on to resolutions. Mr. Klein?
Yes, Mr. President, I move that Senate resolutions 1-7 as written.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Mr. Marcello?
Yes.
Mrs. Danchak Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Carrera?
Yes.
Mr. Klein?
Yes.
Mr. Riley?
Yes.
Ms. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Scalera?
Yes.
Mr. Kaczynski?
Yes. Mr. Spoiler, administration.
Yes, Mr. Kaczynski, I move Administrative Grid Solutions 1-4 as written.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Mr. Carnicelli?
Yes.
Mrs. Sanchez Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Ferrero?
Yes.
Mr. Klein?
Yes.
Mr. Riley?
Yes.
Ms. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Scalero?
Yes.
Mr. Kaczynski?
Yes. Mr. Carnicelli, finance, please.
Move finance resolutions 1-22 as written.
Second.
Discussion. I would like to just make a comment on proposal number 12. I know we were all happy to see this board moving forward with the work that's being done, certainly at the bleachers in the Oval, but the work being done behind Lincoln School and Radcliffe School. One thing that I can say is long overdue. I'm looking forward. I appreciate the help of the commissioners. Commissioner Scarpelli and Sal Ferrar for steering that in the right direction along with Mrs. Shamus. Roll call.
Mr. Carnicelli?
Yes.
Mrs. Danchak Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Ferraro?
Yes.
Mr. Klein?
Yes.
Mr. Riley?
Yes.
Ms. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Scalera?
Yes.
Mr. Kaczynski?
Yes. Mr. Ferraro, resolution personnel, please.
Make a motion to approve personnel resolution number one.
excluding the maintenance night shift position.
Yes, sir.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call, please.
Mr. Cardicello?
Yes.
Mrs. Danchek Hart?
Yes.
Mr. Ferraro?
Yes.
Mr. Klein?
Yes.
Mr. Riley?
Yes.
Ms. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Scalera?
Yes.
Mr. Kaczynski?
Yes. In this section, we allow questions or comments on all school-related matters. Our regulations allow 30 minutes for these communications. Again, each person should be limited to 3 minutes, and we ask you to try to stay within this requirement. As I stated earlier, all statements will be directed to me. First person wishing to speak can step forward.
Chris O'Sea, 261 Grand Avenue. Since you brought it up, last time I had a great year. I'm still smiling about it. But the reason it was a great year is because of your support, Board of Education, Mr. Lasnik, Dr. Milani, who helps me get us started, Mr. Beemeister, who helps me with tech stuff. And about 185 students, 21 teachers, and about 16 assistants, one of which, Don Heck, who actually taught one of the technology classes for 3 days. So, thank you all very much.
Anyone else? Any old business to come before the board? Any new business to come before the board? Whereas the Board of Education will be discussing matters exempt from public discussion pursuant to NJSA 10-4-12, now therefore be resolved that the Board of Education recess to close executive session at this time to discuss personnel and student matters. Be it further resolved that the results of this discussion will be made public by inclusion on the agenda of the subsequent meeting of the Board of Education, or when the reason for discussing such matters in closed session no longer exists.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.